You know that SpaceX already very early on teased the possibility of Starship landing on one of the icy moons in the outer solar system. But is this proposition even realistic?
And why are the icy moons of the outer solar system such an interesting destination in the first place? Well, I would say, let's find out.
When Elon first announced Starship in September 2016, or the Interplanetary Transport System, as it was called back then, we were presented a lot of info on the ITS infrastructure, with of course a heavy focus on Mars. After all, the ultimate mission of the ITS was to colonize Mars. However, during the same announcement presentation, Elon also showed an interesting picture of an ITS standing on a distant object in the solar system. This was definitely neither Mars nor any other object in the inner solar system. No, but this had to be either Europa or more likely Enceladus, from the look of the picture. Then during the latest Starship update presentation from almost 1 year ago, Elon showed this awesome rendering of Starship with the mighty giant Saturn and its imposing rings in the background. But before we analyze how realistic this is, why are the icy moons in the outer solar system so fascinating in the first place?
The definition of an icy moon is an outer solar system moon whose surface is composed mostly of ice. Such an icy moon may harbor an ocean of liquid water underneath the surface and possibly a rocky core of silicate or metallic rocks. The two best examples are Europa, the second innermost of the four Galilean moons of Jupiter, and Enceladus, the sixth largest moon of Saturn. Now, why are those two moons in particular so freaking interesting? Well, because there's strong evidence that both moons could have an ocean of liquid water under their crust of solid ice. A strong indication for that is, for example, measuring the induced magnetic field of the moon, which suggests the existence of a subsurface conductive layer, so a salty liquid water ocean. Europa has a diameter of 1,500 kilometers and needs 3.55 days for one Jupiter orbit. The fascinating surface features you see here are actually thought to be cracks in the ice which had formed due to mechanical stress. The method by which the water below this 15 to 25 kilometer thick ice crust is being kept in liquid state is by tidal heating. Jupiter's massive gravitational field is kneading Europa while it circles the planet, which of course creates friction, which then in turn creates heat. Now, of course, a giant subsurface ocean and a high probability of hydrothermal activity due to Jupiter's tidal forces leads to the very strong suspicion that life might actually exist deep down in these oceans. Contrary to Earth, this ocean is insanely deep. It would have an average depth of 100 kilometers. That's right, 100 kilometers depth of sheer total blackness and darkness, because no light can ever reach this ocean through the thick crust, going deeper and deeper until at some point you might reach the hydrothermal vents. There, life actually might exist around these warm pockets. But there is a problem with Europa. Insane radiation. If you thought that Mars or the Moon have high radiation with 260 millisievert and 400 millisievert of average annual radiation dosage respectively, think again. Because Europa has 5,400 millisieverts per day. That's right, the radiation on the surface of Europa is almost 5,000 times higher than on the Moon and 7,600 times higher than on Mars, or 7.9 million times higher than on Earth. Standing on Europa for only one day would most likely kill you, and even 1 hour outside on the surface of Europa would be enough to reach your total safety lifetime dosage limit for radiation. Because it is located in Jupiter's massive radiation belt, it is brutally bombarded by charged particles all the time.
So yeah, This moon is probably better left to robotic explorers. Our robot friends will drill a hole into the ice and explore the depths of this fascinating moon. In the Jupiter system, Callisto would be a much better target. It's suspected to have a subsurface ocean too, and has much lower radiation, since it's located outside Jupiter's radiation belt. In the Saturn system, Enceladus is, besides Titan, the most interesting destination. Titan deserves an entire separate episode, as this celestial body is one of the most fascinating in the solar system. Enceladus is basically a smaller version of Europa, with a lot less radiation though, comparable to standing on the surface of the moon. It's only one-third the size of Europa, and is thought to have a liquid water subsurface ocean. Actually, we have much better evidence of the subsurface ocean on Enceladus, since the Cassini probe already flew through plumes of water ice, which are ejected in giant geysers from this fascinating moon. Yes, there are geysers of water ice being ejected from cryovolcanoes on Enceladus instead of molten rock. These volcanoes eject molten ice, so water particles, which fall back as ice particles onto the surface. And they also contain molecular hydrogen and sodium chloride crystals and all sorts of salts. Complex organic compounds as large as 200 atomic mass units were found too. And these are the right chemical compositions for the existence of life.
And please consider subscribing to this channel, as it is completely free and would tremendously help us to continue making these videos on such fascinating topics. You can then even vote on the topics for these Friday videos. And of course, you'd have our utmost gratitude. Cassini found that the subsurface ocean of Enceladus is about 10 kilometers thick at the South Pole. So not as insanely deep as the one of Europa, and thus also not nearly as intimidating. Okay, on second thought, 10 kilometers of pure darkness under an ice sheet 30 to 40 kilometers thick is still a bit too intimidating for my taste. Here too, we have tidal heating, which probably causes hydrothermal vents, and if there is life, it too would be concentrated around those vents. Okay, so I wouldn't go down there, but maybe there will be some brave explorers who would do that. But could they?
Well, as you know, Starship is quite large, with an interior volume of 1,000 cubic meters. However, we shouldn't forget that a voyage to Mars takes about 6 months, with some modifications, maybe 3 months if we are lucky. But a trip to Jupiter would be years. A trip to Saturn, even more years. And Saturn is 7 times further away from the Sun than Mars. The probe Cassini, with a Venus and Earth swing by, needed 7 years to reach Saturn. Thus, a manned trip to the outer solar system, launched directly from Earth, would say psychologically almost impossible with the current day Starship. In order to fly to Saturn, first we would need a base on Mars. Then we have to launch the larger Starship 2.0s directly from Mars to the asteroid belt. Then we have to build a base and a refueling depot on Ceres. Only from there, we could plan the next missions to Jupiter. After that, we should build a base and a refueling depot on Callisto. Callisto would be a perfect spot for a larger settlement, plus a larger refueling depot. And only after that, we could launch, when the time is right, a mission from Callisto to the Saturn system. So we really need many intermediary steps before we can send Starship to Saturn.
Except of course, we'd have a giant rotating Starship 3.0, 200 meter diameter spinning wheel for artificial gravity. Then of course, we could also launch a direct mission to Saturn from Earth without the people going insane on these long multi-year trips, since this ship would offer a vast interior space and also artificial gravity. But with current Starship 1.0 and 2.0 designs, which would just be a larger Starship with a diameter of 18 meters instead of the current 9 meters, we only see this happening stepwise. We think that we need to expand stepwise towards the outer solar system. We suspect such missions with astronauts on board towards Saturn no sooner than 2050, since, as we said, for that, we'd need refueling depots on Ceres and Callisto, and bases on Mars. Better yet, bases plus refueling depots at all said locations. So without any major breakthrough of propulsion, be it nuclear thermal, ion, Vesemir, Hall thrusters, you name it, these pictures here would require many bases and many refueling stations along the way.
And we didn't even mention the zero-G and radiation problems on these insanely long trips. But okay, let's say it's the year 2050, and we managed to arrive at Enceladus with a Starship 2.0, making many intermediary stops along the way. And Starship 2.0 being outfitted with adequate radiation shielding and some form of centrifugal rotation. What comes next? Well, after landing on Enceladus, the astronauts would surely set up a base camp, and they would have hopefully been smart enough to bring along a submarine to explore the subsurface ocean. Such a submarine would melt its way down through the thick ice crust. It would employ heat generated through radioactive decay of nuclear material placed at the very front end of the cylindrical submersible. It would liquefy the ice in front and push the water back to its rear, which would then freeze again. Thus, at some point, the submarine would have melted through the entire multi-kilometer ice crust and then enter the ocean. What the submarine would find there, nobody knows. It could be small microorganisms like bacteria, but large flora and fauna near the hydrothermal vents would also be possible.
It will be a fascinating time for astrobiology. Starship or Starship 2.0 would of course be ideal for such missions, as bases could be immediately set up with researchers permanently living on Enceladus who would remotely control the submersibles to ever-increasing depths and make new amazing discoveries. And who knows, one day maybe the submarines would be large enough to dive down with humans on board. That would certainly be an insane experience for anyone brave enough to participate in such a mission. Certainly not me.
And don't forget to vote on the topic for our next Friday's video.
And if you think the icy moon's boring, I'm more interested in Venus, then you can watch this video here. So thanks as always for watching, and then I would say, on to the future. Holy shit is happening. No, it's far too long. Is there alien life? I will just say Venus because I'm too stupid.